Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dave, and I am an alcoholic. I have been waiting almost a year to get up here, and now I got to go to the bathroom. Let me express my sincere love and my thanks to those who have made this night possible. I want to thank them for the committee who has been so pleasantly entertaining and made us all happy and welcome. But most of all, I thank them for affording me one day at a time. One of the things that Dr. Bob and Bill W. left with us and all of those first 100 is the one thing that I came this distant for tonight, and that is that they said, for God's sake, keep it simple and pass it on. I try because some of those who are better big book scholars than I am, but I'm not one who said that I carry the message, but I try to carry the message and to practice these principles in all of my affairs. I want to thank you for the hospitality, and I am not about to start naming names because most of you would get insulted because I miss your name. And that really wouldn't bother me, but it may bother you. I'm going to use these next few minutes to talk about me. It took me a long time to learn how to talk about me. Most of my young life and adult life, I talked about you and your mama, too. I am an alcoholic who suffers from a disease called alcoholism. I learned in Alcoholics Anonymous, to those who was before me, that if I could have taken a fearless inventory even before I started drinking, I would have discovered that I had the ism before I picked up alcohol. I am not trying to create anything original, but you see, I did not pick up alcohol and start lying. I was lying way before I picked up alcohol. I didn't pick up alcohol and start lusting. I was lusting even when I didn't know I was lusting for. I was born in North Carolina and grew up on the farm and is the son of a Baptist minister. Some of you may gather that already. I was not the type of thief or classical thief that you would know before I picked up a drink, but I was a real thief and didn't know I was a thief. I stole when it was not fashionable to steal. I stole things that other people didn't ordinarily steal. My mama would go and cook up pies, and she would put these pies in an old ice box, and she would keep them for Sunday, and she would go off to church and leave the pies for Sunday. Mama would have given me a slice of pie had I asked for it. But I had another ism called greed. So I waited until she went to church and I stole a whole pie, went down in the field and got behind a tree and eat up the whole pie by myself. I had what some of you may call today dope fiending. I don't know what it was. But I know for a fact that I like to manipulate and tell lies on people. I had 6 brothers and 3 sisters. When mama came home and wanted to know who stole the pie, it was very easy and simple for me. With 7 brothers and 3 sisters, the first name come to my mind, that's the person that stole the pie. Mama would whip them and send them on off to the woods, and they could wait for mama to leave and go back to church so they could beat the H out of me. I am going to try to synchronize and simplify my alcoholism by telling you that from that point forward, somewhere along the line, you don't become an alcoholic until you pick up alcohol. And so I picked up alcohol when I was a sophomore in college. But even then, I had all of the ism. When I entered the university down in Raleigh, North Carolina, I was a little country boy who had no prestige, according to some people's standard. I wasn't a football star. I wasn't a basketball star. I was none of those stars. And so they ran me for president of my class. I don't know what happened that year, but apparently they knew I was coming to college. And they went around and recruited about 500 girls. And out of those 500 girls, excuse me, ladies, it is no insult, it's just a fact, 499 of them were ugly. So I ran for president, and I watched my adversary go around and take that one pretty girl and parade her on the college campus. While he did that, I went around and I kissed all 499 of those ugly girls. It should come as no surprise to you that when the election went off, they said, David, 499 votes. Roscoe won. My ism was working for me. I'm the type of drinker who some people would refer to as periodic. And I thank God for this gentleman that I see out there with nearly 47 or 46 years, whatever the number is. I thank God for all of those people who was here before me. Because without them, because without them would be no me. I'm ever grateful for this one alcoholic whom I hated with passion in 1971 when I got here, but whom I love today as if he was my father. He was the first one to tell me the truth that I needed to hear. I was boasting about being a periodic. And he told me that a periodic was nothing but a drunk who was afraid to drink daily. I wanted to kill him. I thought he was insulting me. And so I stopped being a periodic. I never raised my hand again in an AA meeting and said I was a periodic. But I had another character defect which I had not yet worked on called lying. And so I went around and lied. And I says, periodic, I am a moon drinker. I drink by the moon. I come to find out what that meant. And I pass it on to you because it was passed on to me. I am happy that Bob and Bill, when they founded this program, made it so simple. That they made it simple enough not only for me to get it, but they made it simple enough for the generation yet unborn. I have drank in all type of places. I have drank in high places. I have drank in low places. I have drank any place there was a drink. I drank all the way from the tobacco and cotton fields of North Carolina to the White House of the United States of America. I am the ex-special assistant to the late Robert F. Kennedy, Attorney General under his brother John F. Kennedy. I said this not because of Alcoholics Anonymous, but because of what Alcoholics Anonymous has done for me. I want to be honest with every one of you. I am the author of your first civil rights bill. I hope you don't applaud me too loudly, because if you don't have adequate civil rights, blame me. I wrote the bill in a blackout. When I drink, strange things happen to me. I am not responsible for my drinking. I am responsible for the help of God for my sobriety. My wife is with me tonight, and she has only heard me tell this story 3 times. But because it may be my last time, I'll tell it again. When I drink, I ended up in strange places like my own house. I have woke up in my house when my lovely wife was down in North Carolina working as a principal of a school, and I was with the Kennedy administration, and I found creatures in my bed. I am not making fun, but what I saw when I came to is impossible to describe. I found something in my bed one Sunday morning after I had left work down on Pennsylvania Avenue on a Friday. I don't remember what happened from Friday to Sunday morning, but I know something did happen. I looked over in my bed, and there lay a creature beside me. I cannot tell you whether it was a man or a woman. I cannot even tell you whether it was a combination of a man or a woman. All I know, there it lay. It had 2 little teeth sticking out. Hair was going to all 4 corners of the wind. And it looked at me and said, "Don't you remember?" I reached over to get an axe handle that I kept in the bed. And I said, "Yes, I remember. I'm going to kill you." And I went to hit at it, and it stopped me with a smile. 2 little teeth were sticking out. Hair was going to all 4 corners of the wind. And it says, "Last night you told me you love me." The irony of this story is that I actually believed I had totally gone insane. I lived on 19th Street in Washington, Northwest Washington, just above the Washington Zoo. And I got up and I went down to look for my car after I put it out. I said, "Get out of my house and never, never come here again." But when I went to the entrance of the Washington Zoo, I found my car pointed head on to the entrance of the Washington Zoo. When you come over a hangover, you have some strange thoughts. And my mind told me, that's where you got it from. I vowed never to tell a soul about that incident. And it wasn't until you taught me how to be honest about my disease that I began to get the freedom from the discussing and sharing with you my experience so that I may free myself if I do not free you. One of the greatest gifts that God has bestowed upon me, and I offer it only in a manner of trying to offer you hope. I didn't come up here to try to tell you and talk down to any one of you who even got one day. I want you to know, and all of the old timers who out there would back me up in this, if you want to become an old timer as they do down in New York, they don't like us old timers down there. And they want to know, how did you get to be an old timer? And I tell them it's very simple. Don't drink and don't die. I believe in sharing my hope and my experience. I don't talk down to newcomers and tell them I'm as sick as they are. I love every one of you newcomers in this audience, but I am not leaving this podium lying to you, telling you I am as sick as you are. If I am as sick as you are and been here 31 years, AA has no hope for you. One day at a time, one meeting at a time, 1 hour at a time, 1 minute at a time. I have been lifted with the obsession and compulsion to drink. I am striving and working on being happy, joyous, and free. Months ago, I tendered my resignation to a law firm with 322 lawyers, of which I am the senior partner. On my resignation, I had but one thing to say, and none of them knew what I was talking about it. Had it not been for AA, there would never have been a partnership of which I could have created. I will be traveling into North Carolina, where I graduated from, and I share this. And don't you go around saying this guy came up here to brag about himself. I'm just talking about me. If you don't want to talk about you, that's your problem. I hold 5 college degrees, including 2 doctorates. And if I were to pick up a drink, I would be less than a first grader. All my strength and all my hope comes from AA. Having had a spiritual awakening, I have learned how to practice these principles in all of my affairs. If you want what we have, you have to do what we did to get it. I sometimes use a parable when I'm sharing, but I won't do it tonight. I usually love to illustrate what it means, what AA means to me. If I was to hand out a $100 bill out there tonight and ask anybody who wanted it, this place would be bum-railing on me for that $100 bill. But I have something to offer to you that's better than any $100 bill. If you want it, come get it. I was able to get honest about my drinking and then open up my mind to know how insane I was. I never knew how insane I was until I looked at my past. And if I want to continue to remain insane, all I have to do is cease to be willing to have all my character defects removed. I found a God in Alcoholics Anonymous. And if it offends anybody, AA is not designed to offend you. It is designed to help you. Thank God that you can have your God, and I can have my God, and we both can live together. If you have not yet found a God, may you find him now. With the help of that God, I was able to move on and take a fearless look at myself. All of those deadly sins that I discussed in my early sharing, I found out I put alcohol on top of all of the ism, and I develop alcoholism. For you who feel disappointed and disillusioned, I offer you the hope that not only do I have alcoholism, I have it now. I don't have alcoholism. Wasm has been removed. Ism is being worked on one day at a time. Many of these young men, including your great chairperson for this anniversary, know me well. I don't talk down, yet I try not to criticize. But I try to offer hope. I seen a lot of young, beautiful ladies here today. I have watched them as I walked over this great campus and looked at this great convention, this great celebration. And I'm reminded to be honest, My wife is in the audience and she doesn't mind me saying it. I have something to tell you young ladies, and I never could do that when I was drinking. If you did not get me when I was drunk, you cannot get me now. There are so many blessings. I want to think, I don't know whether they're in the audience, but those three old-timers last night, if you are, they're old-timers to me because they had more years than I do. And anyone who has more years than I do is an old-timer to me. And I may be an old-timer to somebody else. But let me tell you, I don't want a single old-timer to ever believe that AA is changing so much that you not need it. If you are looking for personalities and you're looking for someone to applaud you and make you a king, you're in the wrong place. But when I got up here, and I'm really wrapped up now, I was really feeling down and didn't know what to say. But I always know God is in charge. If you don't like the message that I brought to you tonight, don't blame me. Blame God. I am nothing but His instrument. I will go to any length to try to carry this message. It is in giving that I receive. Freely I give, freely I receive. If I can just help one alcoholic out of these 5,000, my living is not in vain. Don't beat yourself up. Go all over the world, as many of you have come here today, not just for this occasion, any occasion that calls for your service. Go. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and over the dales. Tell it because it is all that you have. And it is the only thing that will set you free. I close tonight with the greatest hope I can ever give to you. And I wish you would give it back to me. And I wish you wouldn't be ashamed to do what I'm going to do to you. I want to share with you, every one of you, everywhere, I thank you for this day. You have helped me to be free, free at last. Thank God Almighty. I'm free at last.